Welcome to the Australian Institute of Teaching and School Leadership, or AITSL, the Indigenous Cultural Competency in the Australian Teaching Workforce NAIDOC panel. Bit of a mouthful there. I'm Luke Pearson, Gomeroi man, founder and CEO of IndigenousX. We're helping out with AITSL on the promotion of this project. I'll be leading the conversation today as the panel moderator. Before we begin, I'd just like to stop and acknowledge the traditional owners of the various lands that everyone's coming in from today or tuning in from. I'm on the Awabagal lands up near Newcastle Way in New South Wales. I'd like to pay my respects to the elders past and present and community at large. And I think, you know, given the nature of the work we're doing here with AITSL and you know, why we're here talking about teacher education, I'd also like to give a special acknowledgement to just that full history, the two centuries of Aboriginal students who've been denied opportunity in schooling, you know, through history and still today. Everyone who could have been that doctor, that astronaut, that whatever they wanted to be, that didn't get the support they needed. And hopefully we're working towards a future where they'll get that. The purpose of the panel today is to unpack, have a bit of a yarn about AITSL's cultural competency in the Australian Teaching Workforce Project. Hopefully to encourage a few more people to jump on, have a look at the discussion paper. Submissions are still open if you want to share your own view. So hopefully, yeah, we'll stimulate a bit of convo and get the wheels turning. There's still a window of opportunity to, you know, shape the project. And I know a lot of us have seen a lot of projects come and go, but it's still important that we get in there and make sure our voices are heard when we've got something to say. This project, yeah, in the long run, is hoping to develop a set of tools and resources to improve cultural competency of teachers and school leaders in relation to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander students. Also obviously that has an impact on, you know, the cultural safety in the workforce for Aboriginal teachers, cultural safety for community at large. Back in September, AITSL released a discussion paper, which summarized all the feedback that they've been gathering over the last sort of 12 months or more. This paper sort of builds on that feedback and puts forward a range of other questions, which we'll be looking at in the panel today. So I'm really excited to have the three panel members joining me today, each bringing a really huge wealth of experience and expertise. So first off, we have Dr. Melitta Hogarth. Welcome, Melitta. Melitta is a Kamilaroi woman with almost 20 years of experience in all three sectors of Queensland's education system. At the moment, she is the Assistant Dean Indigenous, got that in brackets, I don't know if we just Assistant Dean Indigenous, in Senior Lecturer at Melbourne Graduate School of Education, pursues her interests in the intersection of education, equity and social justice. Melitta completed her PhD at the Queensland University of Technology, where she critically analysed Indigenous education policy through the lens of the Coolangatta Statement, which is actually like really awesome. I want to read anyone's PhD, but that one I'm adding to my list. I'd like to welcome Sharon Davis, Bardi and Kidja woman, whose experiences in Aboriginal education drive her belief that an equitable, culturally and racially responsive education is key to life successes. Sharon has her Bachelor of Education and a Master's in Applied Linguistics and Second Language Acquisition from the University of Oxford, very flash, and is the team leader of Aboriginal education at Catholic Ed WA. I think that's nearly, that must be an old one, because I think you're doing something else too, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm
Reece. I was going to say. While she was doing that last job, though, she led the nationally recognised Transforming Lives Strategy 2025. And just recently, Sharon relocated to Canberra to begin her role as the Director of Education at the Australian Institute of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Studies, AITSL. So welcome, Sharon. And last but definitely not least, we got Mathew Lillyst, Gundijmara Bunij Mob. He's an experienced teacher who's worked in Victoria, ACT, Northern Territory, New South Wales. Currently, Mathew works as professional practice leader of Koorie Literacy and Numeracy at the Department of Education and Training, Victoria. He's also the author of the short story titled Recognise, which was published in Growing Up Aboriginal in Australia. Welcome, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Unfortunately, you're also impressive and our bios are so long, we're out of time. No, just to kick us off, you know, like I said, we're here talking about cultural competency, but I know a lot of us who've been around, we've seen different names come and go over the years, you know, cultural awareness, cultural competency, whatever it might be. You know, personally, I tend to talk about anti-racism, you know, professional development, Don't be racist, do your job. That's sort of the big one for me. What language do you use when we're talking about this? What terminology best resonates for you? Sharon, we might start with you if that's okay.
Yeah, sure. I think one of the problems that we have, or one of the, difficulties that we have in the space of education is that we have these different this terminology that can be defined in so many different ways by so many different people across so many different sectors. For me, in the beginning, a few years ago, I was into the cultural competency space and thinking about cultural competency as the thing. But it became clear after working with schools and systems and teachers that the term cultural was, weirdly enough, a bit of a problem. And it sort of put up this bit of a wall with teachers in thinking that they can't do it because they're not Aboriginal, so they can't do the culture stuff. So for me, when I sort of had a bit of a look around of what cultural competency really meant, it was more around this responsiveness of teachers and their pedagogy and how they teach Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander kids. And then just recently I've read a little bit of research and some work around racial literacy. And I think I'm leaning towards the racial literacy space and having a racially literate pedagogy.
Excellent. Melitta, what's your go-to?
Well, so I come from a different perspective in that I normally talk about a culturally responsive pedagogy. And I guess it's because with cultural competency as an educator that's actually taught within the vet space, competency has a nuance in it that we talk about for a student to be competent, they have to demonstrate the knowledge or understanding or the skills three times and then they're deemed competent. And so I worry the way in which cultural competency gets read or understood within an education space, because we already have those sort of preconceptions of what competency actually looks like. So, it's quite obvious that it's a continuum in cultural awareness, but we're basically looking towards having teachers be culturally responsive and understanding the students that are in their classrooms is where I kind of end up at the present moment.
Fair call. Mathew, I think you've got a different perspective again, Russ. So where do you sit?
Oh, look, as an English teacher, I find finding the right terminology very difficult. But I think all the things that have been mentioned, they're not mutually exclusive. So they all cover different aspects of what we're really trying to do. My instinct, well, in terms of words that sit well with me, I tend to go with culturally responsive as well. And I think, if we think about our ways of being and, our philosophies of lifelong learning, the competency almost makes it seem like a tick and flick, like it's done, whereas it's really an ongoing process. And I think responsive sits with me in thinking, well, what are the needs of our students coming in? And what do I do that's response? How can I respond to those needs? Because there's a diversity within our students and the histories and the cultures that they bring in. So it's a matter of being mindful of what can I do in my space and in my teaching that doesn't diminish their cultural identity or puts puts them in a space where they feel disconnected from the teaching space.
Yeah, totally agree. I reckon also when it's the ability for teachers or educators to be able to understand when they need to be agile in that space. So, recognizing that this particular way of teaching is not working for this student for whatever reason, whether they be Aboriginal or not, and be able to recognize that and agile enough to change up your pedagogy to be able to suit the child that's in front of you. So when it comes to our kids, I think having a good understanding of our histories, I don't think you have to know all our cultures, or you can't, there's too many, but understanding how history and our history with the education system and how racism impacts the way that you teach is really important. So maybe it's the agility thing as well.
And I think you've hit on some good points there, Mathew, when you were saying it's that a lot of these, they're not mutually exclusive. And, I still dabble in the training space, not just in education anymore, but sort of all around with different mobs, and did one recently in a health setting. And this poor young woman there, when we were sort of 10 minutes in and we were talking about the different Aboriginal capital letters, Indigenous, First Nations, and it was just like, it's so overwhelming. And it's like, like you were saying, Chad, we're so many different cultural groups with so many different histories. We never had a name collectively for all of us. We're never going to get universal consensus even on something like Aboriginal, Indigenous, First Nations. So we certainly aren't going to get universal consensus on cultural competency, cultural safety. And so it's not that the names don't matter, but ultimately I think, sometimes that over-focus on we all need to be on exactly the same page, which is, very rarely comes from mob. I think that comes from the people who are overwhelmed and want to understand. But I think, just saying this, it's not that complicated, but, a lot of these terms, they have pretty huge academic backings or cultural backings or social backings behind them, so that they aren't, interchangeable. And you do need to do a bit of reading and a bit of looking into it. But ultimately, it's, whatever we call it, there's a set of skills and attributes that you can belong to a different school of thought and still get to the same end. So to that point, whatever we're choosing to call it, what does it look like? What are we looking for out of our teaching workforce? What does it look like when teachers are doing it proper?
I've been thinking about that one today. And I really think it does come down to teachers and schools acknowledging that they are on Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander lands, and centering the indigeneity of the land and the country that the school is actually placed on within the everyday working. So looking at when an Indigenous kid comes into the school, or a parent comes in to enroll their child, what are the kind of features that they can see where the country, their Aboriginality is actually being valued right from the onset? That whole idea of knowing the lands on which you're on and knowing place.
Yeah, definitely. I tend to agree. And to add to that, to value add, Ms. Melitta, Dr. Melitta, I think that what it looks like too is a school full of teachers who are not afraid to get it wrong. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like so often we hear that, teachers don't want to say the wrong things, they don't want to offend, so they don't do anything at all. Mm. And that's a massive problem. I think for some reason, I don't know why, it's with our stuff that teachers feel that this fear to have a go. Whereas if you had to go and if you didn't know anything about, maths, that's me, I'm really bad. No, if it's like volcanoes, you go out and research volcanoes, you go take it to this, put together your program, go take it to the science guy and see what do they think, research it. But for some reason, we just have this fear of not wanting to offend. And so it's a school. We tell our kids that it's okay to make mistakes. So that's how you learn. Today I heard somebody say that if we are comfortable, we're never going to learn. So it's being okay in the discomfort and learning from that. And I would hope that teachers can step outside of that comfort zone, because to me that would be what a more culturally competent or racially literate or whatever you want to say workforce would look like. That's self-reflection,
Yeah, and I think that understanding, it's something I talk about a lot. And when saying that, it's like, you've got to be willing to make mistakes. At the same time, don't lean into it and go out of your way to offend people or make mistakes. Do your best to not, but you're gonna. So many different views, so many preferred terminology, so many strategies. And we talk about for any pedagogical approach to any student, you're not going to get it right first time every time, but in the scale of things, like I'll quite often have someone reach out and go, I'm worried about it. And it's like, and of all the things in my life, in my work, I'm trying to deal with, that fear of white fellas not wanting to make mistakes, it needs to be a very low priority on my list. I'm dealing with much bigger things. We're all dealing with much bigger things, trying to get where we're going. So while that fear is real and I respect it, It's sort of like take that leap on your own time, do some reading, do some interacting, engage in the process. But you can't expect us to carry them on that journey the whole way. They've got to,
The fragility in that, in realizing that is just a feeling, and you're not nothing. That doesn't mean because you're worried about offending. And if you do, and you do get growled at, we know, like you're going to make mistakes. Just going to put it out there. You will make mistakes. You might get growled. Does that mean that you will, I don't know, pass away all of a sudden?
Yeah, the guy's not falling in. You're not,
No. And what you do when you make a mistake, you say, oh, sorry. And then you learn from that mistake. So I think we just need to get over ourselves a little bit in some sense. And
but it's also really important that it's led by the school leader.
Yes.
There really is that need of a kind of top-down priority, that this is what the school is going to focus on, and this is going to be something that the school is going to lead.
Yeah.
Because if there's not that advocacy from the top down, then I've seen it before. Teachers that are really keen to do these sorts of things suffer very quickly from fatigue, because they're looking around, watching their peers that aren't doing the work that is necessary, and they wonder why are they? And they become part of that school culture. Whereas if the school culture is actually saying this is important, then action can occur.
That's right. Mathew, what are your thoughts? Right? What does it look like when it's happening?
Well, I guess this is the English teacher in me coming out. I keep coming back to the classroom, which I know is only a small part of the big spider web of everything that comes with our students and our families. But for me, if a student doesn't speak or doesn't put pen to paper or doesn't feel like they can participate, I would question if that space is safe for them. Mm-hmm. And I know I keep saying safe, but I think if the purpose of being culturally responsive or competent, what's the purpose of it? It's for our kids to get the education that they deserve. And I would, for me, it would look like going into a classroom, seeing our students answering questions, participating, sharing their knowledge, sharing what they bring in as well. Mm. And I think that's what it should look like, and it should feel comfortable. But if our kids don't feel comfortable to put pen to paper, then it might be a cultural need, but it might be something else. But we need to be mindful of what we do as teachers in our delivery, and what we say and how we say it can have a direct impact on student wellbeing and participation.
100%. And I'd like to add to that too, like if you have, like we only make up like 4% of the population, 3 to 4% of the population. So in classrooms, largely in the bigger, statistically speaking, you're going to have Aboriginal kids in your class, but they might be largely non-Indigenous kids in there. So teachers need to have, need to be able to deliver a culturally responsive pedagogy or a racially literate anti-racist pedagogy, because the non-Indigenous kids in that room are going to make up the 96% of the bigger population when they get older. They're going to be the ones in Parliament. They're going to be the ones, the police station. They're going to be the ones running the television, the media. So I think, absolutely, it's definitely so beneficial to our kids, our kids' well-being, our kids' education. And then through that, to the way that we can live our lives as the non-Indigenous kids grow up to be that mass in the population.
Mm-hmm. I think, as well with that, extending on, and you're right, so often it's like, I don't have Aboriginal kids in my class. It's like, don't care. You still need to, if you're going to talk about
it. Well, they don't identify because it's not
safe. I was going to say, you might not know when you do all the time either. But, another thing with that is, as a, former teacher, I was part of that, depressingly large group who didn't make it past the 3-year mark. I did 3 years and called it quits. I'd often talk about Aboriginal teachers in the staff room. We're kind of those canaries in the coal mine. I spent 4 years doing my degree. I was paid to be there. I chose to be there. And so if we're not keeping Aboriginal teachers, then what does that say for the poor kids who don't have a choice whether to be in those rooms? I was lucky. I had a few older non-Indigenous women teachers who sort of looked after me, but at the end of the day, it wasn't enough. And, you know, being the only Aboriginal teacher within many schools, not just within my own school, the weight got a bit too much for me. So, you know, what does this look like, you know, at a collegial level? You know, not just in your own classroom with your own kids, but that staff room. And that's, you know, I'd often say, and I'm leaving and still say now, you know, I was like, loved the classroom, did not enjoy the staff room.
And I totally agree, Luke. And it's quite scary when you think that probably only 2% of the teaching workforce are Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander. And so we talk about increasing the number of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander teachers so that the kids have role models within the classroom setting. But it's also about that critical mass and also having that support mechanisms within schools. So you're not the lone teacher, Aboriginal teacher, the go-to, oh, it's NAIDOC week, can you organise something? But actually having those allies and support mechanisms so that you're not just the Indigenous teacher, but you're actually seen as a teacher as well, who just happens to be Aboriginal.
Yeah, that separation I always found interesting. I remember reading at uni where there was this thing, and I think in retrospect it was probably trying to be positive, but it didn't hit my ear well, and it still doesn't. But it was like, be a teacher first and an Aboriginal teacher second. And I was like, I don't know what that means. I can't separate my teacherness from my Aboriginal teacherness. Like, there was such a weird thing. But yeah, the very first comment I had a colleague say to me, very first day of teaching, was, oh, like, you're the Aboriginal teacher. I was like, yeah. He's like, do you need a degree for that? And I was like, yeah. I'm teaching year three. Yes, I have a degree. So yeah, just that language around what it is to be an Aboriginal teacher, clearly a lot to be desired. And like I say, you're going back a few years, but unfortunately I think there's probably a few early career teachers having similar experiences. Matthew, like I said, you're probably the most recent classroom teacher out of the group. Yeah, what are you feeling like in, yeah, not to put you on the spot to out your school, but yeah, what's it like out there at the coalface these days?
Well, I've seen both ends of the spectrum. I've seen schools where they've been very supportive and very embracing, but I've also seen, you know, even in those schools, the small pockets of people who will say things which aren't intentionally disrespectful, or if we may term racist, and it's coming from a place of goodwill, but for us, it's also a bit of a minefield. So, you know, we kind of have to navigate what that looks like in the staff room, but even navigating difficult conversations from students as well, because we have to model how to approach those sensitive topics critically and with empathy. And that can be almost as emotionally taxing as it is, you know, working with your colleagues as well. So when you've got your supportive network in the school, you know, my principals have always been very supportive. That makes a difference. But then when you get loaded with, you need to do this, you need to do this, or could you check this? Over time, that does wear you down. And people will do it out of goodwill, but there's also it's important to say, I need that moment just to have a breather and just to focus on teaching my 10-6 English class who are going to eat me alive in a few moments time. So, you know, it's about, I think the more supportive and open a school is and willing to listen and understand, that contributes to keeping our workforce in as well.
Yeah. And it goes back to what you were saying, Melitta, as well before around school leadership. We need to look at schools as little systems, and to make systemic change and embed that that support that you were talking about, Mathew, into different into the school system. So, you know, if there's a school improvement plan, making sure that Indigenous perspectives are embedded, into the curriculum plan of the school, or that the school has some sort of Aboriginal employment strategy of some kind, has, you know, policies that are, there might be a bullying policy, but is there an anti-racism policy? So trying to put these things at different levels so that they're embedded, it doesn't rely on one person or the Aboriginal staff in the school to do the hard work, and actually creating those allies or accomplices, those allies, to be able to walk alongside you and then be able to, if there are those people, even if it's good intent, it's impact over intent anyway, but if they, something happens, you've got those people who can step forward, non-Indigenous people, to take that challenge and that conversation forward. So it's not always us. So I think that's part of, that's kind of why the culturally, the cultural word doesn't quite fit for me, because I feel like it's, you need to be racially aware, racially literate, like racially responsive in order to then, or that will enable you to be culturally responsive as well. That's my thinking. Anyway, I'm still a bit.
I think for me, and why I've sort of always shied away from, you know, when people have said like, oh yeah, do you deliver cultural awareness training? It's like, well, kind of, but I'm probably making you more aware of white people culture when I'm talking about racism than I am there to teach you about our culture. Because so often, you know, we know culture for any student, any background, like it's everything. You know, culture is this big term that captures everything. When we're talking about Aboriginal culture in so many contexts, it starts to mean this spiritual, magical, taboo thing. And I think that's what breeds a lot of that fear and that sensitivity. And, you know, there are certain things, if I'm, you know, the only Aboriginal person in a professional space, it's like, oh, definitely bring me, you know, these things. I would want to know about those. I want to be able to help those. And as a part of the organization, if you're doing that without me seeing it, we'll probably all get into strife that, you know, save me a lot of trouble from community rather than something going out that shouldn't be. But then there's a whole bunch of things where it's like, oh, you didn't need to show me that. You know, just do your job. I can remember, you know, a lot of the Aboriginal early career teachers back in the day, we would talk about it sort of like, I get every bit of paper with black ink on it. It comes past my desk. And so that workload, you know, Mathew, you were talking about like the emotional workload of, you know, providing a duty of care to students dealing with sensitive topics, maintaining your collegiate relationship with staff who might be saying inappropriate things. But then the actual physical workload that comes with all these extra things you've got to read, conversations you've got to have that are outside of your job. And I think so much of what we're talking about for our students, for Indigenous students and a lot of other students as well, but is that hidden workload that's a part of their life that they're bringing into school. I think, you know, a lot of times so many teachers are like, you're there as this empty vessel for me to pour knowledge into, without that appreciation of, you know, a lot of Indigenous kids are dealing with a lot more than a lot of other kids. Of course, not universally, not that other kids aren't dealing with things, but across the board, we know there are things that a lot of teachers aren't aware of. And so, yeah, when we're thinking about what our kids are bringing and those strengths as well, there are challenges, and a lot of time is that mental energy, that time. So yeah, when we're talking about our kids in class, what, you know, they should, I think, you know, from my point, largely not know what we're talking about. They should just get on with schooling. But yeah, what should that feel like for them? What do we want for our kids, you know, starting off with? I think a lot of us have those stories where we were made painfully aware of being different or othered or outed in school probably earlier than most kids should be. What does it look like when it's not that? What is the opposite of that? Because sadly, I haven't seen as much of it as I'd like.
I'll talk to an example. So through my work at the moment, we're looking at supporting Koorie students in literacy and numeracy and their literacy and numeracy needs. And a key part of that training is looking at how our culture comes through communication. And so things like lack of eye contact as a sign of respect, or, you know, not using direct questioning because that can be too confrontational and it's not really reciprocal or deep and meaningful. When we talk about those sorts of things, one teacher's reported back how a student now feels comfortable to go to that teacher for feedback. So going from not putting pen to paper to now actually taking feedback, which is probably the hardest part of the learning process, it shows that student now feels comfortable just to be them, to speak as themselves and to participate and learn as themselves.
No, that's powerful. Lita, what do you think?
Well, if we're looking at what cultural safety looks like in schools, you know, my dogs are now having dinnies. I guess for me, it's about the importance of community and the ways in which schools engage with community. So I'm talking about there being Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander teachers within the teaching workforce, but also, you know, the liaison officers or education support officers, whatever they're called within the systems. But then also community is represented within that school, in that, so there's policy around that supports that, like within the Coolangatta Statement, as well as the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, that actually says that, you know, community should be able to lead in the decision making within a local space. And I think for schools to get that local perspective, which is written within policy as well, so, you know, they're to teach bringing in the local knowledge into the classroom. So the one constant within every school, because teachers move, so do principals, you know, it's very cyclic. You will go here, there and everywhere. And so the one constant within a school is community. They're not going anywhere. And so who should make so within the Coolangatta Statement, it asks, you know, it says that community should be able to decide what teachers come into those schools. So it's talking about that kind of shift in power as well, and ways in which, or even a shared responsibility, recognizing that, you know, as parents, you give your children to these people for X amount of hours a day, and so where is that shared responsibility in the growing up of these children?
Absolutely. And I think it goes a step further from that shared responsibility, but then the school systems or education systems or schools being accountable to the community then, because, you know, the only way that you can measure cultural safety is if mobs say that it's culturally safe. Mm. And if you, as a non-Indigenous principal, teacher, school leadership group, you can't decide that your school is culturally safe. You can't decide if you can try your best and get guidance and work alongside. But I think in a lot of areas where we fall down a little bit is that feedback that's given by community or by mob is not then valued or taken on board and those changes made. So it really, we talk about two-way learning or two-way education, but it's not a level playing field to start with. So we need to be able to make teachers and school, largely white institutions, need to make sure that they're thinking about equity and that it's not a level playing field, and to take on board that stuff that community and Indigenous parents and families are saying.
And I think that, you know, it's always been a big one for me working with teachers and at university with student teachers, but that idea of, you know, the onus of responsibility around developing that positive relationship. Because like I said, for so many mob, they've seen people come and go. And I often use that analogy of like, how many times, you know, do you expect me to try to pat the dog if it keeps biting me hand? Sooner or later, I'm just going to leave it alone. And so I think a lot of people are kind of at that point. And so if you're coming to show there's a change, you've got to keep coming and you've got to keep showing that change and you've got to demonstrate it and you've got to find ways of getting that message across through, you know, the stories your student tells when they come home. You know, we get our young ones come home and they tell us some things that you can't help but cringe. And, you know, I had one recently. I had to, you know, the PLPs, the personalized learning plan, the teacher rang us up to talking about them and they weren't great. And, you know, by the way, I was in just complete sweats trying to on track, but having this, you know, this fear that my son would face some negative repercussions for me pulling the teacher up, wanting to help them, so that they can help my son. But knowing that if those convos don't go well, you know, there can be a backlash. And I said, I'm you know, an ex-teacher, I was a wreck on the phone. I was sweats. I was so anxious. I barely slept that night. And it just made me realize, you know, how much trauma I still had. And I think about, you know, for my dad, like he got kicked out in year seven. And a lot of that, you know, he was of a generation where he legally didn't have to be let in school. Mm-hmm. Your principal still had the right to deny schooling. So it's like, if that's your experiences and no one's knocked on the door to go, we're trying to be better and we want to hear from you, then why would community expect any different? So, you know, that reminder for, especially I think school leaders, but everyone, like you're the ones getting paid. Mm-hmm. You know, it's your job to convince them, not community's job to assume you're the first dog in a very long time that isn't going to bite their hand if they stick it out.
And there's really good examples like around the place. And I think, I can't remember who said it earlier, like it's not the competency idea that you come and you arrive at this place and all of a sudden, huzzah, you're competent. When teachers and educators understand that it is a lifelong journey, we're lifelong learners. We know that as part of our teaching. And that the competency or the understanding of this stuff is a lifelong journey. And when you get past that fear thing that we talked about before, you can do amazing things. I've seen some absolutely bloody brilliant stuff in schools with non-Indigenous teachers trying their best to connect community, come to a shut door on one side, go again at another side. We help to connect them up with people and then they run with it. And out comes this amazing program that embeds Aboriginal histories and cultures across the whole school. I mean, there are some really good opportunities there. And I don't think I've met a teacher who isn't interested in our histories. Like, it's interesting. Our languages are interesting. When I talk about Aboriginal English to teachers and they didn't know what it was before, and then all of a sudden they want to read books on it. So it's interesting stuff. And I think if we can get past that you have to do it or you're going to offend all these little blockers, there's like a whole amazing world out there.
A funny one that I found, I'd be curious to see where people think, you know, people can start, but that common one of like, I wish I was taught it in school, you know, I wasn't taught it at uni doing my teaching degree. And so there's been this sort of myth that it's like, you should have got the information then, you didn't, so now you can't get it, except for maybe in the, you know, that professional development day every few years, like, you know, there aren't so many authors, writers, teachers, like, so... Yeah, where are some good places to start? Where do you sort of, what's your go-to when it's like, check this out? You know, for me, obviously, you know, self-plug here, go to IndigenousX, check us out. We have a Patreon. We have articles. We have, you know, on Twitter, nice and easy to engage there. It's like, and it's not that, and you know, like you said, Sharon, you're not going to read that and go, I'm now super competent, off I go. But that's one point of entry. You can come in on your own terms, find the voices that resonate with you, and then hopefully that'll lead you on a path to find more. Yeah, where do you sort of tend to point people?
Yeah, working with initial teacher educators, pre-service teachers, my challenge to them always is I start by asking, have they ever been to a NAIDOC event? Have they ever been to an Indigenous specific event? And most of them say no. And so that's the challenge, is to go and be where Black people are and engage with us. You know, Murrays will look at you, I'm sorry, Queenslander, Murrays will look at you and kind of go, well, what's this white fella doing here? But eventually, if you keep rocking up, they're going to engage with you and you can start building those relationships that are so important, like Sharon was saying. You know, if they can't engage with community at a community level and a community event, we're in big trouble.
Yeah.
Because they're dealing with our kids.
Mathew, what do you, whenever that comes up and someone's like, where do I go? What do I do? Where do you send them?
Well, it depends how much time I've got. my quick starting point's actually the IATSL little red, black, yellow book. I know I get the order wrong.
I paid him to say that. That's
free plug for IATSL. No, but I think I always direct them to resources which are written by us or have us speaking, so then they can actually hear us explain ourselves and talk about ourselves in our way. I think in places like Melbourne, it's very easy to direct people to places like the Koorie Heritage Trust or Bundjalaka Museum, just to get they won't get the full picture of everything, but it kind of debunks all those myths or ideas or stereotypes that people might be bringing with them. So I normally suggest those just as the starting point. But as Aunt said before, if they can engage with community and spend time with community, that's a better way to learn meaningfully. And, I guess it makes the learning real and not just textbook heavy, I suppose.
Well, I working at IATSS and also sort of would, before I worked at IATSS, would point people to IATSS stuff as well. But I also feel like what I worry about it when sending people to things that have is all the stuff is in the past type of thing. I really like the connecting with community. I think that's a really important perspective and conversation and connections to make. And I think that there also needs to be that contemporary way of understanding mob as well. So when we're, when we was working with schools back in WA, we do a bit of an audit in the school library, for example, and we pull out all the stuff to do with Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, histories and cultures, and have a bit of a look at what is there. And more often than not, you'd find books from like the 1970s that still said Aborigines and Captain Cook discovered Australia. And so you do this little bit of an audit, and then there's an opportunity to get teachers to understand how to audit, look through the resources in the school. And that's that learning process. I'm really big on leading the horse to water. That's the bad way. I don't know what I'm saying, but getting people along the journey of learning to understand, and then they can run with it themselves rather than giving them sort of the answer. And what's speaking of IndigenousX, who was the person on IndigenousX who was doing the amazing library stuff, Luke?
Oh, who was that? Perry? I know who you're talking about, yeah, but the parent who was going in and de-ascensioning.
Decolonising library. And that gives teachers the tools to be able to understand the pathway of their learning when it comes to knowing about us and our histories, and how those books are essentially racist. And if you have them in your kit that you're teaching kids, then your pedagogy or your content will be racist. So there's that.
For me, that's such a big point where so often teachers will be like, I don't know anything about Aboriginal. And it's like, no, you know a lot. It's just mostly really bad. And so, before you go, I think there's that unlearning that quite often, really needs to occur. And I quite often talk about it if you're walking into a white room with rose-tinted glasses, you think you're in a rose-coloured room. So it's like you won't be able to see us until you understand the lens through which you see us and these artificial constructions that have been made and the stories that have been told about us. All of the, I'm not racist. I've been to Alice Springs, and it's like, that literally makes no sense at all. They definitely have racists there. I've seen them. These weird things of like, I had an Aboriginal friend in school, as though racism means that you hate all other races all the time, no matter what. It's like, you can still have an Aboriginal friend and still think some terrible stuff. So those journeys of unlearning and like you were saying, Melitta, I think it's got to be humanized. So many of those working with Aboriginal people books, like there's a lot of good stuff in them. A lot of them are written by mob, but it's like, if you've never actually spent any time with anyone, it's very dehumanizing. I always like that scene in Barbecue Area where she's going up to talk to the old white woman in the old people. She's like, what are the protocols? How do I engage? She's like, you could have a cup of tea with her. She'd like that. It's just that reminder of like, People are people. You can still engage at a human level and learn as you go and you know, take the time to read and learn. But if it just comes from the book, that's going to be a problem. But at the same time, if it just comes from those individual experiences, that's when you get people go, but I met an Aboriginal person who told me this. And, you know, their heads explode when a different Aboriginal person tells them something different. It's like, we have different perspectives and we're allowed to, and that's okay. So that balance, I think, is, you know, is so important. But yeah, one thing I'd like to, you know, hopefully can we I, can, oh, sorry, yeah, jump in.
Sorry, Luke.
Oh, no, you're right.
I'm also always very conscious that teachers are time poor. Yeah. Schools are time poor.
Yep.
And so another way in which, and I will constantly advocate for the arts, because it's a way in which people can engage with Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander things. And so the poetry of Uluru, you know, even the music of like Uncle Archie and Uncle Kev. And so if they're actually looking at the lyrics of those songs, those political songs, how they acting as a starting point to go find out more information, because if they're time poor, at least they're starting to get some of this critical thinking, you know, also English teacher Mathew, critical thinking, looking for ways in which to make them squirm so they can act.
Yeah. And I think that, yeah, there's such an obvious tie into what we know about engaging students is start with what they like and find ways to engage them with the learning around what. So if you like music, listen to Aboriginal musicians. If you like docos, there's plenty of docos that Bob are making. If you, so, you know, that idea that in that time poor world, like don't think of it as work. And it's weird to be thought of as someone else's work. I'm a pleasure to be around. You should be honoured to come and learn.
Or the didgeridoo stuff. It can be like Baker Boy, or it can be like, books on who, like we're saying before, a teacher who just happens to be Aboriginal. You can be a scientist and just happen to be Aboriginal. We got, you know, astronomers. Yes, astronomers. We've got amazing scientists. We've got doctors. We've got, you know, all these different people who are amazing in their field and are Aboriginal people. So. It's, you know, they can be sneaky with that kind of stuff and just add those bits and pieces into what you're delivering.
Yeah, no, I think there's so much out there. And I think, yeah, one of the, whenever I'm being a little bit cheeky, especially on Twitter, and so I was like, yeah, where do I start? It's like, have you tried Google? You know, like Google Aboriginal, Google Torres Strait Islander, Google, like, there's a lot of stuff there. Because, you know, most mob, you know, whether it's teachers trying to shift the teaching profession, whether it's, you know, whatever, you know, mob are out there trying to influence, they're not hiding. I'm not trying to be quiet about it, you know, and especially like you said, Melitta, you know, that importance of learning that local history, you know, and I often refer to it as, you know, what is that magical process that takes someone from being an owner of their country to the traditional owner? You know, that's very lovely words for what was not a very lovely process, and that happened right underneath your feet wherever you are. So, you know, begin there, find out where you are, what happened to mob where you are, and move on, you know, from there. And I think it's probably important when we're saying, you know, these are some good places to start. What might be the other side of that? What are some paths you try to steer you know, people away from? What might be some of those traps that people fall into? Or because when I say, you know, try Google, that doesn't mean believe everything you read when you get there.
That's right. There's certain sites that people need to avoid.
Mm-hmm. And so without necessarily, I don't know what the defamation rules are around that. So maybe let's talk about. certain qualities you should look for, or certain things you should avoid. So, you know, an obvious one would be Indigenous involvement in the knowledge. Like if you're on a website and it's written by non-Indigenous people, that should automatically be a red flag, which is not to say there aren't non-Indigenous people who know stuff, but if they knew anything, they'd know to be working with mob. So that's a huge red flag. What are the other things they should be looking for or watching out for?
The language as well. If you just, if you Google Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander terminology, whatever, and there's lots of universities who have terminology guides, don't take them as gospel. But, you know, if there are words like out on a website, you don't know if it's an Aboriginal operated or led website, if it says our Aboriginal people, if it says Aborigines, if it doesn't have, if it's all lowercase for Indigenous or Aboriginal, those sorts of little things are little warning signs. It's not all, you know, it's not all 100%, but they should give you those little signs that the information, I'd take that information with a grain of salt.
Mathew, you're an English teacher. You've probably got a few of those little pet peeves. What are the things you keep an eye out for?
Oh, well, it's a bit of a tricky one, and I don't know if I'm going on a tangent here, so please feel free to rein me in.
Tangent away.
But I think sometimes it's hard for people, when they come in, they think they're aware of what to look for. And I think, you know, if I think of some teachers who I've worked with in schools or who I've worked with in professional development, sometimes they will say things unwittingly, not realizing what's appropriate or what's not appropriate. And so sometimes the lens for what they're looking for might not be as effective or as supportive as they need in that moment. And so I think before even getting to my pet peeves, I think it's, for me, it's more thinking about, well, what are the gaps and what are, I guess, the starting points to kind of look at those gaps there. But I think, you know, as Sharon said, those terminology documents that they've got, and they change from university to university and state to territory. But some people might not have the lens of knowing, well, there's a diversity within our communities, and there's a reason why there's a spectrum of how we identify and, you know, how we choose to acknowledge that. But I think, you know, any resource that's kind of developed by community or has the community speaking, then that's the better source to start with, I suppose. I think the concern that comes in my mind is thinking, well, how can we teach that filtering process? Because even myself as a 32-year-old man, my filtering process isn't as fine-tuned as the aunties and uncles in my community. But, you know, I think working out the right people to ask, I think that's kind of the helping there. But I don't know if I've gone on too much of a tangent there,
I think that's great. And I think, you know, one thing you hinted at there, you know, that changing, not just geographically, but over time. And it's like at the moment, you know, First Nations, we're seeing a lot. But if you had said that 10, 15 years ago, people would just assume you're talking about Canada. It wasn't really, you know, popular in Australia. And so that, just because it might have been the voice of the community in 1980, doesn't mean it's the voice of that community now, because we're allowed to change. We're allowed to adapt. You know, so even, you know, when I talk about like my pet peeves or my preferred language, that's my preferred terminology in 2020.
Mm.
It might not be what it is in 2021, and it probably isn't the same as it was in 2000. So that reflexive and like I said, those sounding boards, you know, something I often talk about is, it's, you know, you'll never get the right word that pleases everyone because it exists. But if you can speak to process, we do it this way because we did these things with these people. It's like, oh, well, all good then. Yeah, you might use a term I don't like, but you did it with your local mob. You've got a process in place. You're reviewing it every year. You're doing the best you can. That's got to count for something.
Luke, can I just jump in really quickly, just in terms of teacher practice and resources? There was a conversation I heard earlier to this yarn that we're having now around the importance of having Aboriginal people in schools as the cultural crystal ball, I guess, of everything black, the black
oracle.
Yeah, the black oracle. And there's an inherent danger to that. I get that it can be spun in terms of employment for Aboriginal people, for, you know, putting importance on culture and cultural knowledge and things like that, which is, I'm not saying don't have that, absolutely more Aboriginal people in schools in all positions, particularly leadership. However, the load, and we talked about it earlier, the cultural load on us to be the black oracle for everything is massive. It's so huge. And the flip side to that is that it actually puts a stop to teachers having to do the work that AITSL standards say you have to do if you want to be registered as a teacher, it actually pulls that away from them. And not only are we robbing them from some really amazing learning of the country from which they're on and they're teaching our kids on, we're also, I feel like we're just giving them a disservice. And really, as teachers, we do a four-year degree. We're paid a lot more than what ATA, Aboriginal Teaching Assistants or educators are in schools. It's the duty of teachers and education systems to do that work. So I hear a lot around it's important to connect community, bring community in, have elders in and do all that stuff. I think it's brilliant and we should definitely be doing that, but that's not a free pass for non-Indigenous teachers and all teachers to do the hard work of understanding how the knowledge of our histories and our cultures and racism in Australia has to affect your pedagogy, and that you have to do the work.
Yeah, and I think that's a wonderful point for us to sort of wrap up on. You know, like saying they're not wanting to rob teachers of that journey. As teachers, we want to instill that joy of learning in our students. You need to be able to light that fire in yourself as well and go, we don't expect our students to learn everything first time perfectly. Don't think you're going to either. But get on the journey and enjoy the process. And hopefully, you know, what AITSL are doing, there can be some tools and resources that'll help people along that line. You've got to do the work. So thanks everyone. Mathew, Sharon, Melitta, thank you so much. This has been such an enjoyable conversation. Before we wrap up, I'd just like to let everyone out there know that they can still get involved. You can go to the AITSL website, check out the discussion paper. There's a process to put in your submissions, but you know, we've been working IndigenousX, we've been working with AITSL, talking about having different ways that, so don't feel like you need to get on and write that big 3,000 word essay. You know, you can just hit them up on Twitter, you can reach out, make a little video, do whatever works for you so that you can have your voice heard. And AITSL will be out there listening, and hopefully that will inform their next process going forward, and we can get some really good resources, improve those standards and supports out there for teachers to do their jobs, to do that work with our kids. So yeah, thanks again everyone for making the time. Thanks for everyone who's tuned in. See you later.
Happy Nay Doc.
Happy Nay Doc.